So there is a lot of science behind what ceramic speed does, but for a person who has a mid-range road bike or even a top-tier road bike, but they're packing on a few extra pounds, or their cabling setup was done by kind of any old person and is a bit of a mess, or they're not willing to invest the extra time to get set up into waxing a chain versus regular lubing a chain, then ceramic speed products aren't going to make a lot of sense. You're talking 1 to 2 watts for a $500 to $1,000 derailleur cage, or half a watt for a $200 to $300 bottom bracket. And a lot of these things are actually trade-offs. Sure, a open race ceramic bottom bracket bearing is definitely going to lose less energy than a sealed face steel bearing. It's just a fact. The problem is, will that $200 ceramic bearing get destroyed by a little piece of dirt that gets in it because there's no ingress protection? Yes. Are they more durable? Yes, if they're perfectly clean. Are they more susceptible to damage? Most definitely. If you have an open bearing, then you can throw dirt in it and it will destroy things. Now, there's been strides made in the last few years of trying to have low drag seals, but anytime you put a seal on it, it's going to increase friction. So, if you're at your absolute peak form, you have the best bike setup in the world, and you want to be that 1 to 2 watts more competitive, maybe 4 watts more competitive if you replace everything in that drivetrain, sure, you can spend 1,000, 2,000, 3,000. It's probably about $1,000 a watt in savings. Or you can look at their entirely new, not functional, driven drivetrain. I've seen a few people point out on some of my videos and videos like Solar Frickin' Roadways that they believe you're detracting from the innovation. The reality is, you're not detracting from the innovation so much as providing a technical analysis that they should be very cognizant of. Essentially, a good scientist or engineer should be able to take a look at my math, look at what they're doing, and figure out if it all works, if it all makes sense, and actually think about and come to a conclusion that does it work? Can it work? Do they have a way around the solutions that I'm providing? So, I'm aiming to look at two potential solutions here. So this is the synchronized one. There is a desynchronized version that uses something like what they call synchro, surprisingly, in a car. That has its own pitfalls. We'll talk about that next. But first, let's talk about this. Essentially, when you want to shift, you have two sets of teeth, and you have a bearing in one, and you want to slide that bearing back into the second set. And you want to do it without it touching any of the teeth. So you have to know exactly where the teeth are and where you are able to shift. Because on the larger wheels, you can have a larger teeth differential. So this is like on a regular bike of going up from a 23 to a 25. There's two potential spots that they have synchronized gaps. Or an 11 to 13, or a 12 tooth would only have one synchronized spacing, especially the number of the difference between them relates partially to that number. So we need to have a spinning wheel of murder death with all the like sticking out blades, and we, as that's going by, we need to get a bearing to link in and not hit, because if it hits, it's going to damage the bearing. If it comes close and just catches the edge, it's going to actually cut the bearing, or the bearing, if it's harder and durable enough, will damage the teeth. So you need to, as that's moving now, you need to get it in and then keep going. So in the synchronized method, what we've got is we've got this bearing and these two cogs. We have to shift it from one area to the next. Okay. So it seems pretty easy. But now we have that requirement that if we don't want to destroy this drivetrain, tear it to pieces, and have pieces of metal flying everywhere, we've got to sync them up. So let's take a fairly easy scenario, shifting at 40 kilometers an hour. This is not even excessively hard. The faster we go, if we went to 60, it's 1.5 times faster. Actually, it's cumulatively built, so it actually keeps getting much harder. So at 40 kilometers an hour, you're going 11.2 meters per second in forward distance. That means with a fairly average 700c wheel, you're about 5.3 revolutions per second. That means you rotate, your wheel is rotating in 0.189 or 189 milliseconds. So we can take that information and we can figure out, all right, how much slop, how much jiggle can we accept? And I'm trying, I believe I'm being helpful to the ceramic speed drivetrain by saying 5 degrees at 11, 12 teeth per gear. You're looking at 30 degrees. So realistically, I would think a couple of degrees, maybe two, maybe three. So I'm going to give them five for the benefit of the doubt. That means that the time they have to get that piece in is longer. So we know 189 milliseconds per revolution, and we know circle 360 degrees, and we're giving them 5 degrees. So if you work that out, you can essentially say that for whatever time this is, I have 1.39% of that time to conduct my shift. So that's 2.62 milliseconds. So I'm going to be generous again and say that the distance is only 10 millimeters. The shorter the distance, the easier this is going to actually be. So at 10 millimeters, we need an average velocity for that movement. I'm simplifying this a bit. You can have nonlinear stuff, but I want an average velocity of 10 millimeters divided by 2.62 milliseconds, back to their base units, is 3.81 meters per second. So assuming linear acceleration and deceleration, we have to speed this thing up. It should hit a peak between the gears and then come back down because we want it stopped as soon as it's in gear. We have to have a ramp like this, and that means our peak is 2 times our velocity average, or 7.63 meters per second. So with this constant acceleration, we can figure out what that is. So just take half the graph, constant acceleration, 2 times the velocity average, bloop, equals acceleration times the time, and the time is halved. So we actually get a fairly ridiculous number now, 5,827 meters per second. For reference point, the gravitational force that holds you to the ground is 9.81 meters per second squared. A human in a jet, I think I've heard around 6 Gs, so somewhere around 50 to 60 meters per second squared, a human being will pass out. An airplane's cruising speed is maybe less than, probably 400 meters per second, so 1,200, 1,300 kilometers per hour. That means that you would achieve that speed in less than a tenth of a second. That's half the time your wheel would go around, you would accelerate to the speed of an airplane. We're not actually like anything impossible here. We're way below the speed of sound at 330 meters per second. But we now have an acceleration. We now know how fast that cage of bearings and all that mass can move, and we need to know what that is. So I looked up 6805 bearings weigh about 12 grams each. The prototypes they've shown have all had 12 bearings on their axle, and they need some ancillary stuff to hold it together that also has to move with it, not even including what's called transformer effects, where the inertia of a rotor through a gear down increases exponentially. It's really hard, but I'm going to give them the benefit of the doubt and say it's 200 grams. That the whole mass of that little bit that needs to move is only 200 grams. Realistically, it will be a lot more than that, but I'm trying to be generous and trying to give them every benefit possible to make this work. So force is mass times acceleration. So if a 100 kilo person is standing on the earth, 9.81 meters per second, 981 newtons is holding them down. So in this case, we have our acceleration, we have our mass, we need 1,165 newton meters. So somewhere in the vicinity of 120 kilos of a person would be the equivalent of force from gravity. And that's a little high. That is a lot of force. Most current derailleurs are measured in the newtons and tens of newtons for electronic shifters. They're not measured in the hundreds or thousands of newtons. So to put that in perspective, a reference point might be an e-bike. So let's convert this to power. We have all the necessary things. So power is the force in newtons times the distance in meters over the time it takes for that to happen. And we can, because the force here is opposite and because the time is equivalent, we can just use our base units. So the force is the same for acceleration and deceleration. The distance is the same as the whole thing. And the time is the whole time of movement. So that means 1,165 times 10 millimeters over 2.62 milliseconds give us 4.4 kilowatts. So for the Americans out there, 746 watts is the definition of what is a horsepower. So, you know, like 5-6 horsepower, which seems a lot. Or put in the perspective of e-bikes, the legal limit of an e-bike is 250 watts continuously. That means that this is about 17 e-bikes in order to get the motor and battery power to actually make this happen. Can you imagine having 17 e-bike batteries and a motor that's the equivalent of 17 Bosch e-drives or Yamaha or Shimano Steps drives? You need a huge motor to pull that off. You're talking in the 10, 15 kilos type of range, or some of the smaller brushless stuff. If you only shift once in a while, which that's how we shift, you might be talking 1 or 2 kilos, but you're going to be running that at the absolute teetotal extremes to do that shift. So it's a huge energy demand. It is. And this isn't even taking into efficiency of batteries. You're probably at for most of this, you're well into low efficiency. So you might 1.5-2 times this. So that's one method of shifting. And it's pretty infeasible. You're not putting a motor in that shaft that can produce these kinds of forces. Not without major gear downs. So you do major gear downs. The transformer effect comes in and the rotor inertia goes sky high, and then it's not 200 grams you're moving around, it's 12 kilos, it's 15 kilos you're trying to move around effectively. You're also, the battery power, you're not getting 4 kilowatts, you're not getting 4,400 watts out of an 18650 cell that's in this thing axially. You're not doing it. It's impossible in technology. It's exactly the same as magnetic floating suspension for a bicycle. We're actually in that same territory of realism, that the amount of power you need to have, the amount of energy is just, it's out to lunch. So that concludes my math on a synchronized method for the ceramic speed driven drivetrain. It's not quite feasible. No matter what they say, if they use the synchronized method, there's not enough power that they can deliver into a motor that would actually fit on a bike and weigh a reasonable amount to actually pull off the shifting. Next week, I'm going to dive into the math of using synchros, which is a method to decouple things. And essentially, it would revolve around using kind of like electronic clutches and being able to put those gears in. The potential pitfall of this seems to be, from the math I've done so far, is that you lose a significant amount of energy speeding up and slowing down these synchros, as well as the possibility of wear on the synchros. So that should be next week, if I can clean up the math a little bit. Thank you for watching, and feel free to like, subscribe, or leave a comment, as always.